Hello students, this is Rajeshri madam. I am going to explain you the first chapter of your standard 4 literature, PP Longstocking. In the first paragraph, it is said that once it was a great summer evening when PP entered Villa Vilekula, when the children Tommy and Anika living next door had no idea someone had moved into the house. PP had already entered. As because Tommy and Anika had gone to visit their grandmother for a week, so they had no idea about Pippi. So now we can start our paragraph. When Pippi entered Villa Vilekula for the first time, it was a lovely summer evening. The children next door, Tommy and Anika, were not at home. They had gone to visit their grandmother for a week, and so they had no idea that anybody had moved into the house next door. Come to the next paragraph. On the first day after they came home again, they stood by the gate looking out onto the street. They had no idea that there actually was a playmate so near. They were standing there considering what they should do and wondering whether anything exciting was likely to happen, or whether it was going to be one of those dull days when they couldn't think of anything to play. And just then, the gate of Villa Vilekula opened. A little girl stepped out. She was the most remarkable girl Tommy and Anika had ever seen. She was Miss P.P. Longstocking, out for her morning walk. This is the way she looked. So, let us understand the second paragraph. On returning from their grandmother's place, the next day they stood by the gate and were expecting some excitement in their dull days. When the gate of Villa Vilekula opened, a little girl named Pippi stepped out. For Tommy and Anika, she was the most remarkable girl. Okay, come to the next paragraph. Her hair, the color of a carrot, was braided in two tight braids that stuck straight out. Her nose was the shape of a very small potato and was dotted all over with freckles. It must be admitted that the mouth under this nose was a very wide one with strong white teeth. Her dress was rather unusual. Pippi had made it herself. She had meant it to be blue, but there was not quite enough blue cloth. So Pippi had sewed little red pieces on it here and there. On her long thin legs, she wore a pair of long stockings, one brown and the other black. She had on a pair of black shoes that were exactly twice as long as her feet. Her father had bought these shoes for her in South America so that Pippi would have something to grow into. She loved them and she never wanted to wear any others. So the third paragraph says that Miss Pippi Longstocking's hair was like the color of a carrot. She had two tight braids and they came straight. Her nose was like a small potato and had dark patches all over, and also she had a wide mouth. Pippi even made her dress herself. She had stitched red pieces on her blue cloth. She wore two stockings. One is brown and the other one is black. But the thing that made Tommy and Anika open their eyes widest of all was the monkey sitting on the strange girl's shoulder. It was a little monkey dressed in blue pants, a yellow jacket, and a white straw hat. So this paragraph says that it was strange about Pippi that a monkey was sitting on her shoulder dressed in blue pants, yellow jacket, and a white straw hat. Okay. Come to the next paragraph. Pippi walked along the street with one foot on the sidewalk and the other one in the gutter. Tommy and Anika watched as long as they could see her. In a little while, she came back and now she was walking backward. That was because she didn't want to turn around to get home. When she reached Tommy's and Anika's gate, she stopped. So Pippi was so interesting that Tommy and Anika could not take their eyes off. In a little while, she returned back home, walking backward. The children looked at each other in silence. At last, Tommy spoke. "Why did you walk backward?"
"Why did I backwards?" said Pippi.
"Is not this a free country? Can't a person walk any way she wants to? Let me tell you that in Egypt, everybody walks that way, and nobody thinks it is the least bit strange."
"How do you know?" asked Tommy. "You have never been to Egypt, have you?"
So Pippi stopped at the gate of Tommy and Anika, and they asked her, "Why did you walk backward?" So to their question, she replied that people of Egypt walked in this way. Come to the next paragraph. "I have never been to Egypt." "Indeed, I have. That is one thing you can be sure of. I have been all over the world and seen many things stranger than people walking backward. I wonder what you would have said if I had come along walking on my hands the way they do in the farthest India."
"Now you must be lying," said Tommy.
Pippi thought a moment. "You are right," she said sadly. "I am lying." To this, Pippi said she had been to Egypt and many stranger places. People in farthest India walked with their hand. All these things she said because she was lying.
"It's wicked to lie," said Anika, who had at last gathered up enough courage to speak.
"Yes, it is very wicked to lie," said Pippi even more sadly. "But I forget it now and then. And how can you expect a little child like me to always tell the truth when my mother is an angel and my father is king of a cannibal island and I have sailed on the ocean all my life?" Then Pippi smiled and continued. "And let me tell you that in the Congo there is not a single person who tells the truth. They lie all day long. Begin at 7 in the morning and keep on until sundown. So if I should happen to lie now and then, you must try to excuse me and to remember that it is only because I stayed in the Congo a little too long. We can be friends anyway, can't we?"
Here Anika said, "Those who are not mentally strong, they tell lies. But Pippi forgets to tell truth now and then because she has been living in Congo for so long that it is obvious for her to be like that." When Anika said that it is not right to tell lie, Pippi replied that what could she have done? She was born to parents who lived in Congo and she was never taught to tell the truth. All of the people spoke lies only. Now Pippi asked, "Can we be friends?"
"Oh, sure," said Tommy and realized suddenly that this was not going to be one of those dull days.
Tommy now realized this and thought that with Pippi, these days cannot be dull days.
"By the way, would you come and have breakfast with me?" asked Pippi.
"Why not?" said Tommy.
"Come on, let's go."
"Oh yes, let's," said Anika.
"But first, I must introduce you to Mr. Nelson," said Pippi, and the little monkey took off his cap
and bowed politely. And at last, Pippi asked Tommy and Anika for breakfast. Tommy and Anika steadily agreed. And finally, Pippi introduced the monkey as Mr. Nelson. The monkey took his cap off and bowed politely. So now I hope you all understood the chapter and listen carefully. I have also underlined the difficult words which you can practice for dictation exam in the rough copy. So my dear children, now come to page number 14. Here are the word meanings. You have to study and remember all these words: angel, braided, carnival, caress, freckles, remarkable, sidewalk, stockings. Okay, then come down. Question number 1. Answer the following questions. You have to do it. Then some more difficult questions. Put a cross. This will not come in the exam. Next, question number 2. True or false is there. You can do it in your book. Next, question number 3. Reference to the contest. It has to be done. Then, next is our make sentences. So, after that, see the down part. Question number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is not there. Again, I am repeating. Put a cross on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Students, here are the answers for the questions of page number 14, first chapter, PP Long Stockings. Then come to reference to the contest. Here are the answers. Then question number 3, make sentences are also given. After that, this chapter is finished. Children, after question answer, this is our second chapter, A Night in June. The sun has long been set. The stars are out by twos and threes. The little birds are piping it among the bushes and trees. There is a cuckoo and one or two thrushes, and a far off wind that rushes, and a sound of water that gushes, and the cuckoo's sovereign cry fills all the hollow of the sky, written by William Wordsworth. So this is the poem written by William Wordsworth. So here the poet is talking about beautiful night that occurs in summer. Usually sun takes long time to set in June. So during that period we can hear the little birds chirping among the bushes, stars are appearing, gushing sound of water and rushing sound of wind, and all these beautiful things make the sky melodious. So I completed this poem. Children, in this poem only you have to study word meanings for the exam. Nothing else will come in the exam. Put a cross on question number 1 and 2. Thank you.